I look good.
Okay. On the street and I got my swag on.
Okay.
Get the money, gotta get my bag on.
Okay.
Triple back, flip out the whole scene.
Okay.
All you suckers just the one that be me. So
yeah, I took a lot, Joe.
Dude, you look at whack. I got the big stacks. I push the stacks.
By your sweet, sweet, sweetest, Princess Silke.
Tricks on the wrist, gotta keep it on.
Okay.
What you got? I got it going on.
Okay.
What you got? I got it going on.
Okay.
What you got? I got it going on.
Okay.
What you got? I got it.
Okay.
I got shell toes with the foul laces.
Okay.
Sixth grade, yeah, I have the pink braces.
Okay.
Ask your mama, she know I got the swag.
Okay.
Call me glad, cause I'm always in my bag. So much trip, I'm sleeping, someone please call a plumber. Baby blue, top hat and cane, dumb and dumber.
Okay.
Whipped cream.
I am Yasuki's soft, super smooth, sweet, principessa silkita. I am wise, I am intelligent, yes, kind I am. And here I am sharing in my atacalacho. And beyond. Michelle, I announced. French name for Mike, Michael, or Miguel. I have no clue how he arrived to that little group. And when I say group, it was in Toulouse. It was Nico, my Basque friend, the Spanish Basque friend. He had a group of people around him, and it was always him having the people around him, because he would call him in. And everybody I know, other than the French girl, emanated from him. So I don't remember everybody, because there's like people coming in and out. Mainly, yeah, no, boys and girls. But somehow he was there. Was there not some stupid French girl who was in that little group? I don't know how. I don't really remember where it was, but he was there. Now he is a French person, and in the group, well, yes, students, right? University students. Mainly Spanish, I guess, but he would talk to anybody, to the French and to the Russian and to anybody. I talked to the Czechoslovakian. It was Czechoslovakia at the time. To the German. I would talk to anybody who would talk to me. Absolutely, yes, why not? Or Canadian. Well, that's what happened. But I'm absolutely... Oh, Italian too. I had Italian friends too. You see, I'm totally open, and that's so exciting. It is then that I actually learned to speak many different languages, like in one sentence. That is a biggie when you have not really practiced it yet. In the beginning, it is a biggie. Because it takes amazing skills to jump from one language to the next. I learned it right there, because I had so many like people from different places speaking different languages, and I enjoy the languages, so I speak them, I use them when I can. Otherwise, how could I learn? It was a tremendous headache at the beginning. You know, I pause when I'm listening, right? I'm listening to... Well, I have a few items in my head, but is it relevant to say it right now? So I'm listening. What is there to be said? Okay, so when you speak a second language, fine. When you start a third language, usually what happens is that the words from the second language pop up in your head. So my second... Okay, so I'm sorry. When you speak a second foreign language, or you learned a second foreign language, and then you start with a third one, well, that's what happened. Or maybe I didn't spoke it quite yet. Okay, when I initiated Spanish, okay, first I had German, then I had English, then I had Russian, and then I had Spanish. And then I had other languages. But when I initiated Spanish, invariably, the Russian words would pop up in my head. It's kind of a weird thing, but that's just in the beginning. Until you just start not really speaking it, then things are different. The Russian word knigi, that would pop up. Knigi, Russian word for book. Yeah, of course I know how to spell it. I know how to write it too. I just noticed something a few days ago. I know the Russian G is not the same as our G, but I noticed as I was seeing at the sign, you know how you write a G, it's like a half a circle, and then you have like a hook, right? A horizontal and a vertical line. The Russian G is just the hook. I never noticed it's part of the large G. Never mind. So in Toulouse, France, switching languages, that was a cool thing. I liked it, and well, ever since. Shortly after, I met Robert, and we spoke also different languages. Yeah, in one sentence, in one phrase, we're just constantly maybe switching languages. It feels like that's what we did. I like it. It's very cool when you're educated, because there are certain words which you cannot really translate into any other language. Like sabroso, for example. There's no way. It's cultural condition. Okay, so the song this morning, Cucuru Paloma, I said it, this song, because it says don't be a whiny asshole. That's what it really says. Cucuru, don't cry, but it means exactly that, don't be whiny. So hence it's funny. So Michel, he was a grown man, maybe in his, I don't know, and he had a job. He was an engineer, I think he was an engineer. He was tall and he was there. He had a car and he invited us. It was a little bit out of context, I have to say. It seemed kind of weird. Why would he invite us? But of course he put his eye on me. Not anybody else. I don't know. Maybe because I'm a grown-ass person. He invited us to his house, to his apartment. I was probably intending to get to me. So we went. I have no clue how many. Five? I don't know who was there. But Nico was there, of course. I don't know if Eva was there. I don't know if Carmen. I don't think Carmen was there. I don't know. And he had a large apartment, modern too. I don't remember the building, but it was large and it was modern, and it wasn't ugly. I mean, it was clean. No, it looked neat. But as I looked closer, as I ran to the restroom, I could clearly see that he hadn't cleaned that. Okay, there was like dust layers from like maybe a year or maybe 2 years or maybe even 3 years. That was disgusting, but you couldn't see it at first sight. He was good looking, don't know. She was ugly, no. Good looking, don't know. To me, he seemed a little bit like his face was a little bit like buggery. I don't know how to express that. Something was kind of weird off. I don't remember his function very much right now, but he was taller than I am. Okay, so after the apartment, I don't know what we did, we just hang out there for a while. Nothing really. It seems like it was in the daytime. I have no memory. We didn't eat there. I don't think we know. Maybe he... I have no idea. We hang out for a while. Then he offered a field trip to some of the nearby amenities to watch as a tourist. And of course we said yes, because he had a car. And without him, we would not have been able to see all that. He facilitated it, and of course, it was greatly appreciated. But we could only be so many as it fit in his car. I have no idea what car he drove. Probably a Renault, because he is French and it's France. I am not a particularly favor to Renault cars. So we must have been five in the car. So I was sitting in the front, Nico was behind me, and then two more. I don't know who that was, though. Buildings, you know, old, like, not castles, like, it doesn't matter. Like, it's very old, the south of France. And then another time, he proposed a field trip to the Pyrenees, that's like the mountain. So that was also very cool. I think we only went, Nico and him and I. We stopped at the little town. We did that French thing. We purchased, you know, cheese, wine, and bread. And then we went up and sat on the ground. And it's like when you go to Tahoe in summer to have a little bit of snow, but it's not really cold. We sat there and ate for a while. And then he became all emotional. I think he became emotional. So he continued talking with me and continued inviting me now. Don't know. I only know that once we had lunch somewhere, and I was like kind of relieved in a way, but I was also starting to feel bugged, because the situation is I would walk every second day, 3 times a week. I would walk every day back to my house, to my little tiny room. And I would walk by all these beautiful little romantic places, and I had no money to ever go there. And I felt so like France without going to fair food. It's like going to a hockey game without being able to hold a puck. It's like going to a football game and you're not allowed to look. It's like weird. I was sad. So he invited me, but on the other hand, I was also sad to sit with him because he was weird. He was like, okay, he wasn't weird. He was just French. But it's like no connection in a way. It's like he had an agenda now. But he was like shy, or he was moderate. He was totally uninteresting. I was absolutely never interested in him. Not once. Not the slightest. He continued proposing. He invited me to a concert. Someone would come. A live concert outdoors. I said yes. Because that's what I do. I was bored. I was lonely. And he invites. Why not? It was... he picked it, of course. It was Paolo Conte. Dampen was very famous at the time, kind of new. Totally boring. Some person who like is old and doesn't know how to sing, so he mainly speaks. Look him up. Paolo Conte. And sings in Italian and a little bit in English. It's so boring. It depicts actually Robert Pagliente, I have to say. It seems like it depicts him so like out of rhythm and slow and totally annoying. I would never listen to that. It was strange. But it seemed to me like this is a kind of music like everybody likes to listen to, and even the old folks like to listen to, because it's so simplistic. But well, to come to that conclusion, I had to go and see it, right? So that's what we did. Now, he never proposed anything, Michel. He never laid hands on me. He never had any romantic gestures. And he he didn't give me a rose or a poem or said anything nice to me or anything whatsoever, which could possibly prepare me to what came next. And that is the issue of this story. Yeah, I was so lonely. I was so sad. So he invited me now to go on the weekend. He invited me to his house, where his mother lived, to his mother's house to have lunch on a Sunday. And that would be outside Toulouse. A little drive, I don't remember. I don't think it was a large drive, just a tiny one. So we went, and the house was like large, typical quilting lady house, like every household, right? Lots of shit and carpets and on. Yeah, maybe cozy. Everywhere the same, just like the same as Amagoya's uncle's house, or was it his aunt or her house in Spain? Just the same as the German mom's, just the same. But well, I wasn't expecting anything. So we ate, and then we had a tiny walk. In the forest or so, or in the street, which was like next to trees. No, I'm thinking Spanish, colindar on trees. It was very sad, everything, but here I was and I had food, again, the food. And all of a sudden, Michel says, I talked to my mom and she agreed that we're gonna go move to Mexico. I said, huh? It's like, what the heck? No, that was the last time I saw him, by the way. Where could he possibly draw a conclusion that I would be interested in him? He was so derailed in my viewpoint, so absolutely unconscious of his reality. To whom is he betting his horse on now? Is he stupid? Does he not know with whom he is? Yet then again, I can't really blame him because I don't think he actually could see who I am. He could not see how he was like completely out of his league, out of range, derailed. And I think what happened is, in hindsight, that I was probably the only person or maybe the only girl that actually talked to him. And for him, that meant like marriage. Planning to fly away to his. Right now, I'm feeling so good. I'm feeling so good. In my neighborhood. Feeling so good. So good. So good. I'm feeling
up on my face. I'm in a really good place, and nothing can make me feel down, down, down. Jump back if you're trying to come sideways. I don't need your bad vibes today, but if you wanna change your tone, you can play. But nothing can make me feel down, down, down. And not every day is like this, so I'ma talk of what I got.